Thank you for joining us. This is Common Ground Radio on the Air Nation Radio Network. We are a Basis of Our Lives discussion show where we dish on all the latest in Salem, USA. I am your host, Brandon, and online with us, as always, is my co-host, Misty.
Hello.
So, last week on Days, just a little a preview of what we're going to talk about this evening. Jennifer, Adrian, Julie, Nicole, and Kayla enjoyed some very special donuts that were not intended for them. Family's life is threatened. Will hits his breaking point with Brent. And Kristen has a scare that she never thought she'd have. Could it be true? So, are you ready, Misty?
Yes. Yes, I'm ready.
We'll get right into this week's shows with Monday Show. And this week, Misty will be taking the reins with Monday, Wednesday, and Friday shows. So, take it away, Misty.
All right. Monday, let's see. Where do I want to start? Let's start with where Abe runs into Marge and Theo and Timmy. And I thought it was quite interesting because Timmy had said that his father was dead. And Theo and Abe was just standing there. It was like awkward situation. But they didn't bring up the fact that Lexi was dead yet until a little bit further into that conversation. And I thought it was kind of funny where Marge didn't think that or didn't know that Lexi had passed away, considering she was like one of the top doctors in the town. And she was Abe's wife. And if Joe worked with Abe, you would have think that he would have went to like the funeral for Lexi. It was just funny because I was like, why wouldn't she know that? So, but anyway.
Especially if you have the connection with Steph, though, you think she'd know.
Right.
But I still have this feeling that she has some kind of connection to Stefano.
Right. I do, too. And, yeah, so I just thought that was a little bit odd. And then she was like, oh, I'm sorry, I had no idea. So I guess her and the boys will probably bond over this. So they'll probably become pretty good friends before big goes down with that whole situation. But she had made him promise that he would protect Bernardi's reputation in his name. But she didn't wait for a response from Abe. So he didn't really say that he was going to promise to do that. So I don't know if he will or not. But anyway, so she's assuming that he's going to protect Bernardi's name and reputation. Well, let's see. EJ was in, where were they? Were they in the back part of the town square? Where the bench was? I don't know. Anyway, he handed that man a brown paper bag and that had like 50,000 unmarked bills in it. And he said that he wanted that man to go and find a place to put it in Bernardi's house. And I think he said, find a place that a clever, corrupt police officer would put it. And so the man is just kind of, you know, taken aback because he wants to know why is he targeting someone that had a hero's funeral. And EJ said that he was doing it.
They use that word a lot.
I know. I'm like, but really, was he really a hero or was he just a decorated officer?
We've never seen him do anything that was heroic. But
I know. So I was like, okay, whatever. So I'm like, this man is supposed to be like this wonderful human being, but the only time that we saw him was when he was doing dirty work for Stefano. We didn't even get to see him doing any of the wonderful things that he was named a hero for. So, anyway, he gave him something, I don't know, a card, and told him to, after he hid the money, to call that specific person and put in an anonymous tip, which I'm assuming was Abe, but I didn't know for sure at that moment until later. So, moving on, it's Sammy, and she's getting some food, finally. She seemed very hungry because she said she was going to eat this hamburger even though it wasn't, like, real food. And
First off, what prison serves hamburgers and french fries?
I know, that looked that good.
Did they have a McDonald's in there or something?
I mean, it straight up looked like a Whopper. a double quarter pounder or something.
Yeah, I was going to say Big Mac or something, but yeah, it looked
It looked really good. As I was watching that episode, actually, I was like, you know what? I want a hamburger. I'm pretty sure I went and got one and it went off. But, sorry, I get sidetracked easily here. But, yeah, the food looked really good, but she didn't want it because it wasn't healthy. That's probably why she said it wasn't, like, real food or whatever. Because she's been exercising in that cell, too, doing little sit-ups and tricep push-ups.
I know. She was a workout machine.
I know. I guess she's bored in there. Or she's putting plugs in for the Biggest Loser. Either one. So
I've never thought of that.
She, while she was eating or taking a couple of bites, she noticed that on her napkin, it had something written on it in red ink, and it said, "You're a dead woman." Well, she immediately thought she was getting poisoned, I assume, because she goes straight to the toilet to start thumbing up. And so at first I'm like, why is she doing that? But then I put two and two together. She thought she was being poisoned, and that's why the napkin had "You're a dead woman" on it. Well, the guard's like, what are you doing? And she was like, I'm choking or something, choked on a piece of food. And she hid the napkin under her mattress, if you want to call it a mattress, in the cell. And then he offered to get her some more food, but she was like, no, she lost her appetite. So EJ shows up, and I think she was trying to, she told him that she choked on a piece of food or something. And was there a janitor back there or just a guard? I don't know.
No, I think there was both.
Yeah. So they
came in to clean up.
Yeah, where she made the mess. Okay. I thought that's what I remembered. I wasn't sure. And so they were in there, and so they were kind of, you know, just looking at each other, and he wasn't believing her choking on food story. You could tell by his face. And so when they left, she ran and got that napkin and showed that to EJ, who was, it was hilarious because he was like, I mean, his reaction was just, bloody hell. I mean, I love all the lines for him to say that's what he said. But anyway, I thought, I was like, oh, bloody hell. So anyway, then I think Abe comes right after that. And they're talking or whatever, and he shows Abe the napkin, and they want it to be investigated. And so Abe said that he's going to put the people that he chooses to watch after Sammy, and that he'll have specific people bring in food for her. And I'm trying to see. I think he got – oh, DJ said that he wanted to get with Justin about a new bail hearing. And then Abe received the phone call, which I'm assuming was from the man that put the money in the house. And then, of course, Sammy wanted to know what was going on, and EJ acted like he didn't have a clue in the world what was going on. And then, so after they, I think Abe meets up with Hope, and they obtain the warrant to search the house. And he gets a phone call from Marge. I guess someone called her and told her that they were going to be searching the house. And then they've, you know, like, I'm sorry, but I have to do my job. And then, Marge reminded Ava the promise that he had made earlier, which he did not make a promise earlier because she did not give him a chance to say, all right, you know. So Hope and Abe leave to go to Bernardi's house. And that's all with that particular storyline. Let's see, where do I want to go now? Let's do the JJ, Rory, and Bev. They are, they're in the town square, I believe, sitting at one of the tables. And, of course, Rory is the one that always has the drugs. I don't know where he gets it from or whatever, but he's always the one with it. So he gives... It looked like a prescription bottle, I guess, filled with a marijuana or whatever. He gave that to JJ and said that that's what they would use later that night. And then Bev confirmed the time that she would be meeting him at his house to meet his mother. And then, of course, Rory
really
wants to
come.
Looking
forward to this date.
I know. She was really excited.
Did she know that Rory was going to be there?
No. I don't think so. I think she thought it was just going to be the two of them because, remember, they were going to have their little Twilight marathon.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
She thought it was just going to be her and JJ.
What every teen boy wants to watch.
Aw, and he crushed her dream by bringing Rory along, you know? But anyway, so I think during all that, Nicole was watching. And it was funny because Bev was like, who's that weird woman staring at?
She was kind of creepily watching them. I love Nicole, but I mean, it was really creepy.
She was just like standing there, and I don't know how she had her arms, but she had that look on her face, like she, like, I know what you're doing, and you're not going to get away with it. Look on her face.
I know what you did last summer.
Yes. And so, I think they talked a little bit, and he let her know that he had been arrested for that shoplifting incident, and that it was all just a big understanding. And then I think she noticed that he had something in his pocket. And, of course, she didn't know exactly what it was. Like, before, when she saw him in the park or whatever, and he had that cocaine in his pocket, she didn't know what it was in either. So she's just thinking that he's got something in his pants. That sounds funny. In his pocket. And I think she might have told him, I don't know, that she warned him about something, and he was like, oh, I'm scared now. That's the only part of that little conversation that I really remember. But anyway, so she knows he's up to no good, and he doesn't really like her right now. And then while all this is going on, the book club is happening, or it's about to happen, at Jennifer's house. Adrian shows up, offers to help. She says she's pretty much got it done except for making the donuts. Did Adrian even help make the donuts?
No, she went in there and helped herself to a donut after they were done.
Yeah, that's right. Because I thought, wait, did she actually help? I don't think she did. So, let's see. Oh, JJ comes in and he's like, you know, let me help you make the donuts. I've made donuts before when I was little, blah, blah, blah. And she says there's a lot of leftover dough or whatever. And so he gets this grin on his face and he's like, okay. So he's thinking, you know, I'm going to put the marijuana in the donuts because he didn't want them on his pocket. Because after that run-in with Nicole, he was a little bit paranoid and didn't want to have anything on him. So he puts that in the batter and makes some donuts. And here's what's funny is, why did Adrian trade the donuts? I don't know why she did that. Because she looked at them and she's like, they're ugly or whatever. Or these aren't very, I forget what she said, but she
said that she wanted to give JJ the better batch, I thought is what she said.
Okay, I missed that. Because I was like, why would she trade them? I guess she wanted to give him the better batch to impress his girlfriend.
Yeah.
But anyway, so while all that's going down, or while they're making the donuts or whatever, or after they make the donuts, I'm not sure, Bev shows up. And she plays off as a little good girl in that she met JJ in summer school and they both share a love for Ernest Hemingway, which I was sitting here thinking, is this real? Because no, it's not. And then later we find out, yeah, how they really met was over marijuana.
No, so sweet.
Yes. So romantic. And then, Nicole shows up for the book club, and they almost spill her $20 bottle of wine on the donuts. I thought that was pretty funny, because all of them just started cracking up when she said that.
I guess working at a convent pays well.
Yes, it does. And so I wonder what she gets paid. I wonder if she's paid anything. She might not, because since she lives there. Anyway, It pays for room and board, so that's why she had to get $20 bottle of wine. and then when JJ and Beverly, they meet up with Rory in the park, and he has a run-in with Daniel. And he was like, hey, buddy, staying in shape. And then he said that he needed to worry about, he needs to start worrying about how he's living his own life instead of worrying about how Daniel was living his. And that's about it with that story. The other things that happened on Monday was Teresa sold the symphony tickets. Daniel showed up and was asking, she went some sob story about Sammy. And he offered to go for a walk instead of a run so that they could talk. But then she gets a phone call from Kayla, who treats her like a 12-year-old child, telling her to get back to the office now and write Jennifer an apology letter. And I know, I was like, really?
Teresa was
really. And also, Hope got a phone call, didn't she? Did she get the phone call from Bo? Yeah, she got the phone call from Bo in that same day.
Julie was there, too.
Yeah, Julie. And I think that's all for Monday.
So, with the book club in mind for Monday's show, is basically what a majority of Tuesday's show is about. And that's what I want to focus on for my discussion with Tuesday's show. Well, I'm going to bring up JJ because he's part of it. So I'll start out with Bev, Rory, and JJ. So I'm going to start out with that. So Bev, Rory, and JJ were in the park. They had JJ had the donuts, and they were all chowing down on them, having a good old time. They were talking, Bev and Rory were talking about college. I believe Rory was talking about the classes that his electives he wanted to take. So he was going to take calculus and chemistry, I believe. I don't know what kid in the right mind would take calculus and chemistry as an elective. But anyways, JJ said that there's something wrong with his picture. They're wondering why they're not buzzed at this point.
That part was pretty funny because they were talking about, like, serious stuff and not their normal Beavis and Butthead conversation.
It's like the donuts were having the opposite effect on them.
Making them smart.
Yeah, for one. So we switch back to the Horton House, and all the ladies are there. Make sure you know who all was there. Kayla, Adrian, Julie, Jen, and Nicole. Now, I believe Hope was there for a few minutes, if I'm not mistaken. I think she was there for a few minutes, and then she got called out on police business. But all the ladies are there, and they're already eating the donuts. And they're all licking their fingers because that must have been a pretty darn good donut. Julie said, I've never ate a donut so fast in my life. And Adrian talked about how good they were. She was like, I think Adrian said, you know what these donuts are? They're good. And they all agreed with her, all of them. And,
Julie was hilarious.
I watched it out there. They all reached for seconds, but Jennifer was the last one to reach for seconds, and there wasn't one left for her. But somehow later in the show, she had another donut, so I don't know if she went and made some or whatever, how that went down. But anyway, switch back to the park, and JJ is trying to understand or trying to think about why they're not getting buzzed right now. And then he all of a sudden has a realization. He's like, oh, my God, I know what happened. Then we switch back to the Horton House. Ladies are enjoying their second donut. Talking about, I believe they're discussing the book at this point. They're talking about, the book was Alice in Wonderland, I believe, was the book. They were reading or something like that, an adult version of it or whatever.
Yeah.
They were talking about the tea party that the rabbit had or whatever. I haven't read Alice in Wonderland, to be honest with you. So, I mean, maybe I did not remember. But
it was pretty funny because she was like, "Were they really mad?" The Saturday.
Yeah.
Adrian.
Kayla, I think Kayla said something like that. Jim was like, "Wow, Kayla, wow." She's like really impressed with what Kayla's astute observations of the book. Well, not so.
I know, it was hilarious.
And then Cole was sitting over there. She's like, "I got to be honest with you, ladies. I thought this was going to be boring, but this, yeah, this isn't boring." It basically was. And then Julie chimes in. She says, "You know what's boring? Cruising." And they all look at her, very befuddled. And she said, talking about how she goes cruising with Doug. And Doug, she said that Doug was telling her about, look at the water. And Julie's like, "There's freaking water everywhere." And all the ladies are just staring at her like she's completely nuts, even though they're all completely stoned by this point. And they're out of nuts, of course, so Jennifer dashes to the kitchen to make some. And they all stare at her as she leaves, hoping that she, you know, hurries back to give her more donuts. So that goes to commercial, and they come back from commercial, and Jen is pouring Nicole some wine. I believe it's her $20 wine or whatever that she's having. So they're not only getting high, they're getting wasted, too. What a party. I think they were all drinking wine. Then Kayla brings up another point about the book. She says, "Do you think the Dormouse made it?" And then Jennifer is really into what Kayla said, and she's like, "Wait, what? What are you talking about, Kayla?" She said, "Do you think he drowned?" Or wait, no, this is Nicole. Nicole says, "Do you think he drowned? Oh my God, I'm a vortex of emotions." Or vortex, I think.
Yes.
I went from
happy to being completely sad.
I know. She
was mad.
Exactly what she said. I'm a vortex. And of course, Julie had to chime in with her random 2 cents. She said that she hates bouquet lines. She said, "I don't want to see pictures of you and your." I don't know. They all said this word different ways, but they said, "I don't want to see pictures of you and your sheep zoo." What they're trying to say is. Shih Tzu. You know, the dog, the little tiny dog. Is it Shihtzu or something is how it's spelled. Anyway, that's my point. And they're all, Adrian, Kayla, and Julie, and Jennifer are all trying to say what she was saying.
And they're like,
Shih Tzu. Shih Tzu. Shih
Tzu, Kayla, yeah. Shih Tzu. Oh. Or something. It was hilarious. I was rolling in that whole scene.
And I can imagine that these actresses probably had a great time building the scene as well. The ladies got hungry, so Kayla and Adrian ran off to the kitchen to find some food. And they came back with some pretty random food, too. So Rory tells, back to the woods, Rory tells, not Rory. JJ tells Bev and Rory that I just realized why we're not getting buzzed. We made 2 batches of the donuts, and my mom has a book club meeting tonight. And they all, and then Bev and Rory got this look on their face. They started laughing, and JJ dashed off to go home. And Rory said, "I think I have this right. I hope they're reading 50 Shades of Grey."
Yes.
Oh my God, that kid. I'm glad he stuck around. I wasn't liking him at first.
I know.
He
cracked me up.
Back to the house. They got their food. The ladies got their food. I believe they had, Jen had a thing of chips. Kayla had a jar of pickles and a jar of peanut butter. And Jen says that she hopes that it's not past the escalation date. And then Kayla's like, "I don't think that's the right word." But then I just forgot about all that and whatever. So they pass the pickles. They pass the pickles. I'm sorry. They pass the pickles around. And Julie took one out of the jar, and she looked at it, and she said, "Eat me." And then she passed the jar to Adrian, and Adrian took the pickle out, and then she looked at Nicole and told Nicole, she said, "Eat me." And Nicole said, "They'll never say that to me again." I can't even say this without laughing. Oh, boy. I'll try to contain myself. So then Nicole starts to have these, she starts to get a little grumpy, so she's not so happy right now. So she's like the grumpy high, you know, person that has a different emotion from all the other ladies. She goes off on them how they're like treating her differently or whatever, and how they're judging her. And she says, "I forget. I need to go to the bathroom. Where's the bathroom? Where's the little girl's room?" And Jen said, "It's the same place it was last time you lived here." And she's like, "Well, I'm glad you didn't change that on me."
And Jennifer was like, "Is she mad?"
She seemed really upset that she'd be mad, too. It's so funny that they're friends now. So they're all, Kayla's enjoying, Kayla just had a pickle, and now she's eating peanut butter. And Julie has something to show them that she picked up when she was out doing, you know, traveling the world. She has handcuffs. I wasn't sure how to react to this when she pulled them out. But she said, what was the word of the magician? I cannot remember the word of a magician that does this. I can't remember. I'm sorry, I can't remember the name. But anyway, she learned this trick from a magician that she could unhandcuff herself with a paperclip. But she needed a paperclip, and she asked Adrian, but Adrian said that she's not an office supply store. She doesn't have any paperclips with her. But luckily, Jen does, and the paperclip's blue, and Jen's very excited. It's a blue paperclip. She's like, "I have a paperclip that's blue." She's very excited. Julie tries the paperclip, but it doesn't work. She tries about two or three times.
It's like a magic trick, but it wasn't working.
She's like, "Drum roll," and she did it like two or three times, and nope. I think Nicole was gone at this point, but she had returned from the bathroom, and Nicole was like, "No one said there's going to be props." Then Kayla, I don't know where this came from, but all out of the blue, she was talking about food, and she really wanted tacos. And Kayla was very persistent on wanting tacos. I mean, she really wanted tacos, and I really hope she got some, because we didn't see if she ever did. As we said, Julie couldn't get out of the handcuffs, so Jen had an idea to call her cousin and confidant, is what she said. I quoted her. That's what she said. Called Hope for a key, and Jennifer got her phone, and she screamed in it, "Call Hope," and Kayla said, "Call Hope what?" And then they all started busting out laughing, except for Nicole, who looked like she was, I don't know, she almost looked like she was disgusted or something. She looked grumpy standing over there. So Hope got the call from Julie, and Hope wasn't sure what to think because Julie said that she was handcuffed, and Hope said, "I thought you were at the book club." She's like, "Oh, I am. I'm there." And, of course, then Hope realizes that she's probably had too much to drink, which isn't the case, but that's what Hope thinks. Julie tells Hope that she needs her to bring her a key so that she can eat soup again. Because they were talking about that earlier, how if she was handcuffed forever, how would she be able to eat? And then I think Adrian brought up, how would she be able to go to the bathroom if she was handcuffed? And of course, Kayla asked Julie to ask Hope about tacos. And at the end, Julie was like, Kayla wants tacos. And then she hung up on her. Kayla was like, "Did she hear you?" I don't think Hope did, so I don't think Kayla got her tacos, sadly.
I know.
I love tacos, too. I'm kind of in the mood for tacos now, just talking about it. Anyways, getting off track. JJ finally showed up at the door, and when he got to the door, it was kind of dark, but you kind of saw a smile on his face. You could tell Casey Moss was having a hard time keeping a straight face when he was getting ready to do these scenes. Then a cop showed up behind JJ at the door, and Jen came to the door. The cop had keys that Hope had requested. Hope said, "You're a police officer, and we have donuts." But she couldn't come in because he got pulled out. But Jennifer said, "Thank you, first responder," and he left. So JJ came in. And then Nicole saw JJ standing there, and she was like, "Are you part of book club, too? How come no one tells me anything?" Very depressed. Very angry.
So funny.
I love her. Oh, my gosh. If they ever lost Ari Sucker, I'd be so heartbroken. Julie, for some reason, Julie called JJ a dirty rat. I'm not sure where that came from. I guess it's not really all that false. JJ goes and uncuffs Julie, and JJ offers to clean up, and they all say how sweet of a boy he is, if only they really knew. And they're all really thirsty, and they all want water, so JJ goes to the kitchen and cleans the plates off and whatever. And as soon as JJ left, Caleb's looking around the room and at the table, and she just says, "What happened to the donuts?" She really wants some more donuts. I guess she cried about the topic all of a sudden. Now she wants donuts again. So the ladies end up leaving. Adrian was the first to get out the door. Then Julie followed. She was, like, singing to JJ. I'm not sure what she was singing. I'm not going to sing what she was singing because I can't sing a second. I don't know what it was. Nicole is standing there just giving these weird looks to JJ, and she says that she's catching on to JJ. She's not sure what he's doing, but she's catching on, and she's going to figure it out. And then as she leaves, she's like, "I wonder what the cab driver's going to say when I ask him to take me to a convent." And the last of the scenes was Jen and JJ. Jen is looking at a family photo album, and she's getting all sappy. She wants more donuts, but JJ doesn't think that's a good idea. So JJ sends her off to bed. JJ's looking at, I believe Nicole left some book, her book back, and he's looking at him and says, "Man, they all went down the rabbit hole." And that is how the book club ended on Tuesday. That was just awesome TV. It's nice to see Dave take a break from all the dramatic and serious stuff for, you know, a little light moment, so to speak. But there's more on Tuesday that I didn't get to. I'll just bring up briefly. Gabby went to go visit Rafe in the hospital, who might I bring up that Gabby was wearing this dress, this shirt that had these birds on that looked so real. You know how we like to critique the wardrobe. Kate runs into Stefano and his lady friend in the square, and Stefano and Cicely is her name. They're acting like a teenager. Gross, but whatever. I think Kate had flowers to take to Ray, is what she went into the square for. We had some EJ and Sammy scenes, in the jail. I think she was sorry. We had Hope and Abe scenes where Hope, they were getting ready to go search Bernardi's home, but the cop had found a box from the Bernardi home, and they went searching for it, but there was nothing in there. And we had some EJ, Hope, and Abe scene, and EJ was surprised to learn that they found nothing from their search of the Bernardi home. Gabby came to the jail cell to visit Sammy, and she had a video of Rafe. Rafe was telling Sammy that, that was actually kind of sweet.
It was sweet.
Yeah, Rafe.
I got Rafe teared up.
I didn't go that far, but I mean, they were sweet. Rafe says that he, Sammy, and if she says that Bernardi was a crooked cop, then he believes her, and he is going to be praying for her and thinking about her. And this, of course, this got Sammy to tear up as well. Well, she didn't say she was crying, she had something in her eye. EJ and that man that he had hired to put the money in, Bernardi's home, they had a little scene, and the man isn't sure why the money's gone. But we see that Stefano and his henchmen together, and he is the one that had stolen the money from the Bernardi home. We had some Kate and Rafe scenes as well towards the end. Hope came to visit Sammy in the jail to warn her to keep her man under control. And then we ended with some Stefano and EJ scenes where EJ confronted Stefano about Bernardi, but of course Stefano said nothing. Well, we all know that he's on Stefano's payroll, but of course Stefano will not admit that. So that is all I have for Tuesday's show, and we're in the Wednesday show right now with.
All right. Let's see. No, you cover Tuesday. That was the best part of Tuesday was definitely the book club. Definitely. All right. So Wednesday, let's see. Where do I want to start?
So the Will and Brent confrontation.
Yes. That was how I think the actual episode started. They were at the Brady Pack. And Will was going, I guess he was talking to Sonny and said that he was going to go and tell his great-grandmother hello. And when he walked away, Brent walked in the front door, and he laid out the blueprints of the designs on the table that they've been working on so that he and Sonny could look at them. And then Brent said that he was really looking forward to his vacation, and Will returned from the kitchen. And he heard Brent saying to Sonny, have you had any more thought about accompanying me on the trip? And Sonny reminded him that, you know, they'd already talked about it and he couldn't take any trips for a while. And then Will kind of made his presence more known. And as he did that, Chad walked in the door. He was looking at the designs and he agreed that they looked great. I think he told Sonny, the best thing that you did was bring Brent onto this project. And Sonny said, we make an awesome team. And then
and
Will
was standing back there, he kind of felt like a fourth wheel.
I know. He was looking so sad. I don't know if he was upset, sad, or angry. He was just maybe a little bit of all that.
He was a vortex of emotion.
Yeah. I was like, oh, I hate when he looks sad, though.
But he does it good. Does it well.
I know. Awesome. So then Sonny, I think he started talking about he was going to have a spot for a future club to open up another one? Okay. And so, and Chad had said something about take things one day at a time. Of course, I don't know what's going on with Chad right now. And Britt didn't think they should pass up an opportunity to expand. And then Will said he had to leave to take Ariana's sun hat to Gabby, which I was very proud of Gabby for being with Ariana finally by herself.
I know, what a surprise.
I was like, whoa, what's going on here? but then Chad, yeah, well, you know they needed to do that because she's not been with the baby really since it was born.
Exactly. She's
always been with Will and Sonny. So, anyway, I'm just like, what mother isn't with our newborn. Anyway, I'm getting off track again because it just irritates me because I'm like, really? It's like all the mothers in Salem just leave their kids with whoever.
Yep.
All of them. Sammy did, Gabby is, whatever. So, but instead of Will going to take the sun hat to Gabby, Chad offered to do it. He said he was going that way anyway, and he wanted to see the baby. So he left.
I thought I would get one. I think I'm going to get one. I like it. I thought it was a cute sun hat. I think I want to get one just like it.
Oh, yeah.
It would match Sonny's pants that he was wearing that day.
Totally.
They were like pink pants or something.
Yeah.
Anyway, sorry. Go ahead.
Okay. Hey, now you're talking about fashion, not me. Okay. We switched roles for a minute. But I will say, though, Kate's nail polish. Okay, sorry. I'm off track. Is that green looking lime color? I love it. So anyway, Brent had noticed that Chad seemed a little down, which nobody else even seemed to say anything. Like his own really close friends there didn't notice, but Brent did. That's another thing. I was like, huh, whatever. So Sonny went, where did Sonny go? Because he like went away for a minute and Will confronted Brent.
He came back. We don't know where he went though.
Yeah. So they were alone, Brent and Will, and so he confronted him about asking Sonny to go to Bryce Canyon again when Sonny had made it clear before that he did not want to go without him. And he said, do me a favor, stop asking him, okay, back off. And he said it in kind of a stern way. And I guess
he was
Brent
all
was
like,
taken
back off my man.
Brent looked like he was taken aback by it because he was kind of like, you know, look, yeah, he was, I think his quote was, look, I don't know you very well, but I was hoping to get to know you better if you and Sonny would come on this camping trip with me and some of the other guys, making it seem like he didn't want just Sonny there.
Right.
And then I think Will had said, you know, if that was the case, then why didn't he invite Sonny when Will was present? Why did he invite him when it was just Will and Sonny, or just Brent and Sonny together?
Right.
And he insisted that they were just friends. They've always been just friends, that Sonny wasn't his type.
Oh, please. Sonny's everybody's type.
I know. I was like, okay. But Brent did say that he was envious of Will and Sonny's relationship. He was leaving. Yeah. And Brent was leaving, and Sonny was trying to say bye to him, and he just acted like he didn't even hear him. He just kept going, didn't even say anything.
That was kind of rude.
I know. I mean, it wasn't Sonny that was giving you a hard time. It was Will. Anyway. So Will actually told Sonny that he pretty much attacked Brent for asking him about the trip again, and that he hoped that Brent wasn't too upset about it. And then Sonny reassured him that, you know, Brent's a good guy, that he's not going to be upset, and that they share a lot of friends. And he think it would be cool if one of them just happened to be gay. And Will agreed.
Mm-hmm.
And then Sonny reassured Will. He said, I want you to know that no guy or girl, gay, straight, or indifferent, is going to come between us. I know how lucky I am. And then they kissed.
Actually ripped his shirt off.
Yes.
He, like, reached across the table and ripped his shirt off.
They liked it that way. And they didn't care that they were in the middle of the Brady Pub.
It's a family restaurant. When you're here, you're family. Oh, wait, that's all.
Let's see. I'm going to just go with a little bit. When Chad Bevesy showed up where Cameron was and gave the hat to Gabby, very quickly just, you know, had a small conversation. He saw that Cameron was there and, you know, didn't really want to stay. So he, you know, ran off or whatever. And then Cameron said that he can't stay either and ran off after Chad. And he told Chad, you know, what's next? And he was like, you know what's next, chemotherapy, is he going to do it? And he was like, dang straight, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do whatever it takes to beat this thing. I didn't want to go into that part too much because I've got something else to go into right now, and that is Brady and Kristen. Okay. So Kristen was having a bad dream of her with Eric in the hotel room. And apparently she had been tossing and turning all night, so Brady wondered, you know, why she was doing that. And then Kristen had just said that she had been dreaming that she was finally with the right man, which I thought was odd because if you're having sort of a bad dream where you're tossing and turning and, like, the look on her face didn't look like she was having a good dream, why would you say that? I'm like, didn't you at least say you were having a nightmare or something? Why'd you have to say that? So anyway, they kiss or whatever, and then Kristen asked if they thought they had made a mistake. She was worried that Brady was playing her. He assured her that he wasn't. He said that even though they had both acted impulsively, they should take things slow still. But he did want to commit to her. Kristen said that she already knew that she wanted Brady now and forever, and that she was fine with taking things slowly. And then they had said that they couldn't stay all day in bed together, that she had to go and interview scholarship candidates at the rectory.
People actually work in that now?
Yes. You'll get into that one, but oh, that scene was so sweet. So then, let's see. Oh, Brady said that he wanted to take her on a date to celebrate their reunion. And so she was excited and said, yay, you know, we're going to go on a date or whatever. And then she told herself quietly, it's going to work. But I think, you know, she's trying to convince herself that nothing's going to come out, everything's going to be fine, and it's going to work out with her and Brady. Let's see. Back at St. Luke's, Daniel was talking to Eric, you know, about all that evidence that Mason had collected and that it had all been ruined and that it was unlikely that they would ever figure out what happened to him and, you know, why he had gotten so sick all of a sudden. Eric didn't seem too concerned with it. He just said that they could chalk it up to God working in mysterious ways. And then Daniel pointed out that if it hadn't been Brandon, whoever had tried to harm Eric could try it again. So that's where his worries come in, not necessarily really finding out what had happened, but that they could come after him again if they didn't, you know, figure out with the evidence. So they have a little heart-to-heart. He had told him, you know, about when he first came to Salem, he had just lost his wife, Rebecca, and then he immediately got into a relationship with someone who was already committed to someone else, and that a lot of people have been hurt. But he said that the tables have been turned, and he had experienced the effects of infidelity from the other side. And then he said that he was going to live his life more openly and honestly with no more lies or secrets so he could set an example for Parker.
I was a little confused by this, his talk with Eric. I didn't understand at first where this was going. Of course, I found out later, but it was just kind of confusing to me where he was heading with this speech. I had an idea of where he was going with it, but I don't want to bring that up. I'll keep that to myself. But, yeah.
And at first, too, I was like, is he trying to do confession? Because you know how he really just believes in science. Like, he's never been a religious-type person either.
Right. Right.
So I'm just like, oh, he's opening up to Eric because he considers him his friend, not necessarily his priest. But anyway.
Yeah, that makes sense, yeah.
And then Eric had guessed that it had to do something, had to do with Jennifer. Daniel said that Jennifer had proposed something that he knew would be a mistake, but he might lose her if he didn't go along with it. So Eric told him that he found that, you know, in times like that, that prayer would guide him in the right direction. And then that's when he said that that really isn't his thing, but he'll give it a try. Chris was outside the door listening in. And when she entered, Daniel kind of looked surprised, you know, why was she there or whatever. So she explained that they were going to be working together. And she wondered if she was in the call out for sandwiches, if they had to work through lunch.
Well, I mean, what else did you do, so...
And then I guess Eric kind of knew that, you know, no, he didn't want to do that because that would really make Nicole mad if Kristen tried to send them out for sandwiches. So he said they would just order in. Oh, it's pretty funny. So first, Kristen and Eric meet with a little girl named Sarah. And Sarah had good grades and she was, you know, had a well-written application statement. The girl's mother said that she wanted her daughter to have the best education possible. So she hoped that Sarah would be eligible for a scholarship. And Eric and Kristen just kind of looked at each other, and during the interview, and Sarah's mom wondered if the two were old friends because she said that they were working well together. And Eric actually said no, but they were just getting to know one another, which I guess is semi-true because he was a lot younger when she was in the picture before. But Kristen calls the girl back into the office while Sarah was touring the school and informed her that they were happy to welcome her daughter to the scholarship program. She was very, very excited and said that she had just learned that her and her husband were expecting another child. And Kristen pulled out her cell phone, and at first I didn't know what she was doing. I was like, Why is she on her cell phone? Rude. Well, this woman is talking to you and you're on your cell phone. But anyway, she was telling Eric that, you know, she had taken a home pregnancy test, and Kristen just looked like she saw a ghost or something. And then that's when I realized what she was doing. And, yes, so she was just like, oh, my gosh. Well, meanwhile, Brady runs into Daniel in the Horn Town Square, asking if he still has the symphony tickets, because that's what he wanted to use for his date night with Kristen. But he told him no, that he didn't have them anymore. So then Brady shows up at the rectory door and asks if Kristen's there. Kristen was inside. She was checking her calendar, and she said to herself, I'm late. I'm really, really late. It's not possible. It can't be. And so she was just freaking out silently to herself. And the only other thing from Wednesday was JJ told Roy that he had gotten rid of all the evidence from the donuts and the marijuana. But it was funny because Abigail was about to take a bite out of one, and he goes running in there. He's like, you can't eat it. And she's like, you know, what's going on? And he was like, I sneezed on it. And this was hilarious. Her and Jennifer both were like, ew, JJ.
Simultaneous. Yeah.
And
they're all,
I mean,
family. What's the point? What's
it was so funny.
They were,
I mean, because they were like, ew. Like, it was like the worst thing possible that he could have done. And also, Abigail
confessed.
Yes, she confessed about seeing the video before it came out to Jennifer. So Jennifer wanted to call a lawyer and make sure that nothing was going to happen to Abigail during all this. And then also JJ and Abigail had a little sweet moment about how he would be there for her, or he would look out for her like she's been looking out for him. And that is it for Wednesday.
We saw a lot of the Horton Kitchen this week for the first time in years.
I know.
I think three or four times this week we saw the Horton Kitchen. It had, like, stainless steel appliances, and then the it was, like, white. I kind of stuck out like a sore thumb. I mean, I'm no interior designer or anything. I'm just picky, and I point things out just for fun. Anyways, let's get into Thursday's show. What I want to focus on for Thursday's show are the Kristen scenes, and I'm going to talk about the Kate and Ray scenes. We don't often talk about them, so I want to get into them. So the Kristen scene starts out with Kristen saying that she's late. She's really late, and it can't be. She's looking at her phone, as Missy said. So then we switch to the hospital, and Kate arrives. Maxine tells Kate that Rafe is stubborn as ever, and she's asking for her. Maxine says that Rafe's in a mood. So Maxine tells Kate that she's the only one that can cheer him up. So he goes to see Rafe, and he says that he doesn't understand how she can believe Stefano about Joe. Was there more of Stefano or Kate and Rafe on Friday? I can't remember. I don't think so.
Yes.
Okay. Well, anyways.
And there's no Kate, but Sammy.
Oh, okay. That's right. Oh, the real estate. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Anyway. back to Kristen. Eric and Brady are arguing outside of the rectory door. Kristen is in the rectory. She's saying that she says it can't be. She says, I cannot be pregnant with Eric's baby. Then enter Eric and Brady right after she says that. So Kristen automatically assumes this is Eric's baby, or she knows it's Eric's baby. Brady asks her what's wrong with her. She says she needs a moment alone with, or Brady tells Erica he needs a moment alone with Kristen. Kristen says that she's overwhelmed with all the scholarship applications that she has to look through. Brady wants to know what really happened between her and Eric. He thinks that something's going on between Eric and Kristen. Well, something's not going on, but there was something that Eric doesn't remember. Anyways, Kristen has a flashback of her and Eric. And I'm noticing a lot of Eric and Kristen flashbacks to the time that she seduced him. And if you remember, the last time that we saw a lot of flashbacks with two people having sex was with Will and Gabby.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they shoved those Will and Gabby flashbacks down our throats.
Mm-hmm.
So, with all these Kristen and Eric flashbacks, I mean, we can automatically assume how this is going to end. But we'll see. Maybe it's Brady's. Maybe she's not pregnant. I don't know. I'm pulling for it being Brady's, as you all know that I love Kristen. Anyways, Kristen tells Brady that her and Eric are getting along just fine. So Brady just leaves it at that, and he leaves. And Kristen is wanting to leave too, but Eric says that he needs her. Back to the hospital, Kate tells Grace that she isn't saying that there isn't a connection between Stefano and Joe Bernardi. But Rafe, she says she's not really defending Stefano or Joe, but she's just saying that he wasn't trying to kill Rafe, we know that he wasn't trying to kill Rafe, but he was trying to injure him, so to speak. Rafe says that he's not going to let Sammy lose her life. Back to the directory. Eric needs Kristen for an interview with another scholarship applicant. She says that she's reluctant because she really had to go. Well, she wanted to go to the store and buy a pregnancy test. she's reluctant, but she will do it. Rafe, then back at the hospital, Rafe thinks that Stefano lied. doesn't he always? Kate said that when Stefano gives his word on the Demira honor, it's pretty safe to say that he's not lying. But Ray says that his word is worth nothing. He's nothing but a lying, homicidal maniac. I can see that. He's not the one that does it. I mean, he hires people to kill, injure, whatever people. But, Ray's right. So, back to the rectory, the new applicant, or the applicant, is Haley. She is raised by her second cousin, I believe. She had lost her mother 6 months ago, and Haley is very, very shy, very reserved. Eric tries to talk to her, but she won't say anything. So Eric takes her second cousin out to talk with her, at least Kristen, with Haley. And Kristen tells Haley that if she was in her situation, if she was sitting where she was, she'd probably do the same. She says it's fine if we just sit here and talk. Kate tells Rafe that they get off the subject of Joe because it's just turned into an argument. They begin talking about, she wants to find a subject that'll make him smile, but that's kind of hard at this point. Kate tells Rafe that his physical therapist is one of the best, said that he is one of the best. So Kate automatically assumes that it's a he, because the name is Jordan Ridgway. Little does she know, but we find out later. He doesn't really want to talk about this, so then she brings up Ariana. And then he does get a little smile on his face, but then he says that he couldn't hold Ariana. Gabby had to just put her on him because, he's pretty much, he can't move his limbs from his neck down. Rafe is very sad, so to speak. Rafe then brings up jury selection for Sammy's case. Kate says that you don't need to focus on this right now. You have to focus on your recovery. Rafe is worried if he's brought up to testify how that's going to work and everything. Maxine enters because she needs to take his vitals before PT because physical therapy is getting ready. His physical therapist is getting ready to come in. So Kate leaves, and Rafe tells Maxine that he'll cooperate this time because, Rafe isn't the best at cooperating with Maxine. So Kate leaves the hospital, and she walks by this nurse. It looks like a nurse, but it's a physical therapist. She's very – I'm not a downer. She looks very homely, just to speak. who the actress was, you knew that this is who is going to be the physical therapist. We didn't find her name out. I don't believe we found her name out last week at all, but I gave it away if you didn't know. So we switch back to Kristen and Haley. This scene was very, very, very touching. I tried to write down everything Kristen said. Kristen told Haley that she understood what she was going through because she had lost her family at a very young age. Kristen was very mad, and she was very sad when she was Haley's age. Haley begins to cry, and so does Kristen. Very much. It was just beautifully done. I'm going to try to quote everything that Kristen had said here. Kristen tells Haley, "Things are going to get better. You're not always going to be so mad. You're not always going to be so sad. You're going to realize that the people that you lost are still with you in your heart. They want you to be happy. They want you to feel safe. It's going to get better. I promise you, Haley." And then Haley jumps up and goes over to hug Kristen. Just very beautiful, very emotional scene. Very well done by Eileen. You're starting to see a different side of Kristen right now. I'm not sure how they're going to continue to write Kristen, how they want to write her out, but I'm wondering if this is a change, a new leaf we're seeing in Kristen. Maybe not. Maybe, I mean, I love Kristen no matter what, but just very, very beautiful scenes there.
Mm-hmm.
And as Kristen was, Kristen and Haley, I think Eric, I'm not sure if Eric heard the whole conversation, but he was standing outside of the door, and he heard some of it. And Eric entered, and Haley left because her cousin was done with Eric, so they were getting ready to leave. Eric says that he sees Kristen in a new light now, but Kristen doesn't really want to talk about this. I believe she kind of attacked Eric in a way, and she apologized. She says that she's just confused right now. She's not used to these feelings. And, of course, this is pertaining to Brady, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or she did.
So she says.
She says she's not used to these feelings, and she has all these circumstances, and Eric's not sure what these circumstances are. She just says that she can't talk about it right now, and she leaves, leaving Eric. Anyways, back to the hospital. Brady's asked Maxine about the physical therapy, and Maxine says, "I'm not going to lie." She says, "It sucks, it hurts, and you won't think it'll get better, but it will." And she says that she believes Eric can do it because he's strong and he's determined and he can beat this. And Maxine leaves, and Rafe tries to move his hand, but to no avail. And then the physical therapist entered. She was standing in the doorway watching him. She didn't say anything. Rafe spots the woman standing in the doorway, and he was like, "Are you new here?" And she says, she's like, "Yeah, my name is," and then EJ entered. So we get to hear the name. EJ wanted to talk to Rafe alone. And then the very last scene of Thursdays was Kristen was at the store in town. We don't know. What was I going to say? I totally just... the store. The store was... I don't know. I was trying to think of if it was a previous set on days, but I couldn't tell. It was a very small store. But anyways, Kristen was at the store, and she was looking at pregnancy tests. And as she was doing that, Brady came up behind her, and Brady sees her, and he says, "Kristen?" And that is how those scenes ended on Thursday. What I didn't mention on Thursday's show that I didn't get into was Nicole and this man had an encounter. She was at the beach. And by the way, this man that Nicole talked to, he didn't have a name, but I was watching the credits at the end of Thursday's show, and his character name was Sexy Man. I watched the credits, and that is literally what it said. No joke.
Sexy
so
Man?
That's what it said. If you go back and look at the credits on Thursday, that's exactly what it said. I took a picture of it with my phone, so I'll have to send it to you.
That's hilarious.
I swear that's what it said.
Oh my gosh, that is so funny.
We had some EJ and Justin scenes where they were bickering back and forth about Sammy's case. Happy Jay is handling this, trying to take it into his own hands. Sammy is at the jail getting ready for her hearing, and this guard is very cordial, very polite with her, because this is the guard that Abe had hired personally. He said that Roman had saved his life or something like that, so he's going to do everything he can to protect Sammy. And we had some Brady and Nicole scenes. I guess a big part of Thursday's show was we learned that they were having a ceremony for the one-year anniversary of the explosion at Chez Rouge. Well, it was underground and it blew up Chez Rouge. So Brady and Nicole talked about Madison. We also have the courtroom scenes with Justin, EJ, and Sammy, and the DA, the prosecutor, Melinda Trask, Chester Trask. We also had Kate and Sammy scenes where after Kate left the hospital talking with Rafe, she went to Sammy's jail cell to talk with her, which you find out more on Friday, which was a very, very great scene there. And then we also had some Nicole and Eric scenes at the end. Yeah, that is all I have for Thursday's show.
All right. Okay, so Friday, I'm going to go into just the little details of the other stories before I go into the big details of the ones I want to talk about. Maggie was taking Parker to build a fort in the backyard with a nanny, and she started talking to Daniel about Jennifer, and that was the one-year anniversary of that explosion, and that he needed to be there for Jennifer, and he said he sent her a text. Also, during all that, Abigail texted Daniel, and JJ said, I can't believe you're talking to him today of all days. And then Abigail was like, look, JJ, Mom needs him, so you just need to get over yourself and think about what's best for her. That was that little bit. They didn't really do much for that 100-year thing, just that little bit. I'm trying to remember Jack. Eric and Nicole talked about the scholarship program and Kristen, and she said she was complaining about having to work with her. And she said something about you need to see her for who she really is or she could destroy us both. And she leaves. And then Eric was on the phone with Marlena, who just hung up on him. He said she's never hung up on him before. I thought that was kind of funny.
She must have really been mad.
I don't know. I was like, oh, gosh. But then Maggie had stopped in and was meddling in that whole situation with Eric and Kristen. And Nicole stopped by the hospital to talk to Daniel more about JJ and that someone needs to tell Jennifer, about what she had saw. But Daniel wasn't having any part in it. And then... that's about it on those. Okay, so now I'm going to go into detail. Let's see, which one I want to do? Kristen. I'll do this one first. So in Ray's hospital room, the woman, again, it says young, pretty woman in a Ray's hospital room, and she was about to say who she was, then EJ comes and knocks on the door, and he pretty much has ordered her to get out. And
you can do that when you're a demure.
Yeah, you can. You can order people around. and then she kind of looked at Rafe and was like, do I go or do I not go? And he pretty much, agreed to have her wait outside. EJ said that he wanted them to work together to help Sammy. And he, told him that he felt horrible that she was in jail because, she was trying to save his life and that he had been unconscious. So he didn't see anything. There was no way that he could help. EJ said that if the two of them could figure out a way to figure out why Bernardi was in his room, then they had a good chance of freeing Sammy. He said that he, hadn't remembered anything that would help. He kept going back saying he couldn't remember anything. Bernardi never did anything bad towards him, They weren't friends, but they weren't enemies. He says, what if you were able to reflect back on what happened and maybe you were able to recall that Bernardi stopped at a bank or a safety deposit box on occasion while you were on duty together? And, trying to come up with a scheme. Of course, Rafe wasn't having any part in that. He was like, no, false evidence is bad. It's only going to hurt Sammy. This is a bad idea. And AJ, he said, the only crime that she committed was saving your sorry life. he said, I think that your tremendous ego is so bruised that you're willing to punish Sammy, or he calls her Samantha, by having her spend the rest of her life in prison. Well, I hope you rot in this bed for just as long. Clearly upset. I think he called him a smug, sanctimonious SOB or something. can't remember. And then, all this is going on, Sammy is all upset. She's got like, she looks like she was stuck between the wall and the bed when she was sitting down in there when Kate got there. And then they wanted to talk about Stefano. And she says, I'm not a bit interested in talking to you, Kate. She has said that she believes Stefano because he wouldn't swear on the DeMira family name if what he was saying wasn't true. And he said that he was not intending on killing Rafe. He said that even though he humiliated Kate in like front of everybody, dumped her, just made her feel worthless, that she continued to do everything, that he had said to do or whatever. And so they start talking about that and how she pretty much loathes him for how he had treated her. But she said that she does believe him and that there is something missing and she cannot figure out what it was. And so she wanted her to reenact what happened the night that she was in Rafe's hospital room, the night that she shot Bernardi. And they're still trying to figure out why he had a razor. You know, why did he not have a knife? Or, you know, why a razor? And they also, she said that it wasn't near his head. And then she told her to stand exactly in the same position that Bernardi had been in. And then she realized that she was, like he was closer to the foot of the bed and mm-hmm. that he had the sheet in his hand. And so they were like, well, was he pulling the sheet down to slice his throat? And, you know, they were like, no. And so she kind of took her hand and like came down like she was going to slash and realized where it would have landed. And then they were both like, oh, my God. Seriously?
Their facial expressions were the best.
Yeah, they were both like, ah. And then they were like, oh, he wasn't trying to kill him. You know, they figured out what he was really trying to do. And then Kate said, that would have been a waste. She didn't say that to Sammy. She said that to herself. But I thought that was pretty funny. She was like, that would have been a waste. And, of course, she would think that because
she wouldn't have me. Then.
She wouldn't have her little boy toy. but Sammy asked Kate to leave because she didn't feel like, you know, looking at her anymore. So then young woman, we still don't know her name yet, she stopped back by Rafe's room, and right before she's going to introduce herself, Kate comes in. She tries to dismiss the woman because she was like, you know, she wants to speak with Rafe about his physical therapy, and she said, you know, she didn't want to talk to anyone, so the physical therapist was there. And then she says, she is, I'm your physical therapist. Kate completely looked like she was about to pass out because she saw that the physical therapist was going to be a man, not this woman standing there. Meanwhile, EJ comes back to see Sammy, and she tells him everything that her and Kate had just went over, and that was all that story. And then the other thing that happened on Friday was, you know, Kristen was at the drugstore. She had her hand on the pregnancy test when Brady, you know, scared her. And then she played it off as if she was trying to buy some tissues because she had interviewed that little girl and they had a heart-to-heart and she had been crying. And he didn't really buy the story. You know, he wanted to know why she's lying to him. And then she admitted that she was lying. And so then Brady deserved to know the truth. Excuse me. Well, as they left, they were having coffee in the Horton Town Square. And he asked him why she lied to him. And she turned the tables again, acting like, you know, that day, bringing up the day that it was Madison's, the anniversary of Madison's death, and that, you know, and he even admitted that he was hated thinking about losing Madison. He didn't want to talk about it. He was just really upset about it. And she said, let's see. Kristen said one of the best things about getting back together with Brady was getting to know how much she liked him. And they had a little moment there. And then Brady left, and Kristen purchased the pregnancy test. And we're above this little store because she didn't buy that test. It had to be right there in the town square somewhere.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, she didn't buy it there, I don't think. Unless Brady left and we just missed when she bought it. I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, because I'm like, how did she get this pregnancy test? Well, anyway, she has the pregnancy test. Jennifer runs into her. She drops it, and Jennifer's just like, oh, my gosh. You know, like, she's completely in shock that she saw the pregnancy test. Well, Kristen, like, grabbed it up and, like, took off out of nowhere. And then Jennifer follows her, and she's like, oh, my gosh, are you pregnant? And, you know, Kristen's like, yes, or whatever. And but she's like, she was like, oh, I'm so happy for you. I know that you've always wanted a baby, and you and Brady, you know, are going to have a wonderful whatever. And she's like, you know, trying to be really sweet and, like, really happy that she's pregnant and that it's Brady's. Well, then the look on Kristen's face pretty much gave it away that she was thinking that Brady wasn't his father. So Jennifer was like, oh, my gosh, you know, what in the world? So then she had explained to her, you know, that when they weren't together, she was with another man who was in a committed relationship. Yeah. With God, not another woman. And so Jennifer said, well, do you want me to stay with you while you do the test? And she was like, yes, that would be great. So while Jennifer goes to call work that she's going to be late, Nicole shows up. And that is how Friday went off. So that's crazy. What is she going to say to Nicole? Or is Nicole going to see that test?
I don't think Kristen, well, we know Kristen is quick on her feet, so I don't think if Nicole sees it, some excuse to say it's not hers.
Mm-hmm.
I assume. And then just a side note, I've said it 100 times, but I just I love the Jennifer and Kristen relationship. I don't know what it is about. I guess it's just because it's like such an unexpected relationship, I guess. I mean, those two are so different. I wouldn't understand, but just
yeah,
there.
And she deserves to have a good friend. Kristen does.
She could, yeah, I mean, she had no sad to say, but aside from Jennifer.
Yeah.
Okay, so that is all from last week's Days of Our Lives. Covered a lot.
Yes.
So I this week will be covering the spoilers. So for the week of August 19th, Grace grows frustrated with his physical therapist Jordan.
Dun dun dun.
I was like, he convinces Marlena to work with him to break up Brady and Kristen. Team Victor. Let's see. Try to squish their name. Marlena. Team Marlena. the celebration at the club is interrupted when Teresa and Vargas' date ends in violence.
Uh-oh.
In this club, I'm assuming it is Chad and Sonny's is Common Grounds redone, is what I'm assuming the club is.
Mm-hmm.
Thursday, get your pee buckets. Nick and Gabby love. Not to be rude at the Nap fans, but I'm kind of interested to see how this happens, considering where they are right now. I mean, how this happens. I'm assuming it probably happened a little authentically. Anyway, and then the special prosecutor offers Sammy a reduced sentence, which comes at a very high personal cost. So I don't know what that is. Really interesting to see what that else was as well. Steve casting information. August 22nd, John Douglas' last day on days. We're going to head back on August 22nd, so it seems that Sean Douglas is out of days. Mark Bernard is with Robert. Green will be sitting around with them for a while. And then last thing is, well, that's all I have, but just like I said, welcome to Dave's. Chriselle is a physical therapist. We speak last week. Chriselle South was recently on my children. So, anyways, welcome to the Dave's cast, Chriselle South.
Yay!
So, there's this. I wanted to get into an interview that didn't happen up here, and we don't have time to talk about it. But Casey Chandler, Massey, Blake Berry, and did an interview. I wanted to bring that up, but we'll get into that next week. I haven't even read it myself, so I'm kind of interested to see what that was all about. So, that is all we have for today's show. Do you have anything to add to the show?
No, not for the week in Salem. I'll be doing the interview with Travis for Gowtown Divas tomorrow night at 10 Eastern Time with Sean Douglas, who plays Vargas. So if you guys want to tune into that or call in and speak to him, we will have him on.
Awesome. So make sure you follow Gowtown Divas on Twitter and like them on Facebook, and make sure you have the link for tomorrow night at 10 Eastern Standard Time. Gowtown Divas is also a part of the area, so it'll be on Block Talk Radio as well. And us here at Common Ground Radio, I will be promoting the show as well tomorrow, so if you ever just find it. So just last thing I'd like to bring up is Common Ground Radio. You can find us on Facebook. If you'd like to go on Facebook, just type in Common Ground Radio. You'll find us. Our logo is on that, so it should be pretty simple. Twitter, you can find us at CGCommonGround. And follow us there for all the updates. I think he's in the chat room that tomorrow night, follow us at CG Online Radio, follow at Gowtown Divas, keep up to date, to find the link for the show tomorrow. So, with that being said, I think we can close the show tonight. Thank you to everyone for joining us, and we hope that you can join us again next week, same time, same place, as we dish on the week that was and same of our lives. So, for Common Ground Radio, this is Brandon.
This is Misty.
Good night, everyone.
You've been listening to Common Ground Radio with hosts Brandon and Misty on the Air Nation Radio Network. Thank you for joining us.